And let's just magnify his name. And let's just say a word of prayer right now. In the name of Jesus, we come before you, Lord. And we just thank you, God, for the opportunity to be in your house. We thank you, God, for the opportunity to be in your presence. We're looking forward to a mighty move from you, God. We're looking forward to a mighty move of your anointing. We're looking forward, God, to yokes being destroyed and chains being broken. We're looking forward, God, to what you have in this service, God. In the name of Jesus Christ, right now, we pray in Jesus' name. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. He's worthy. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I won't keep you standing. I want to read a scripture in Judges chapter 6, verse 11. I've used this scripture quite often, but the Lord has brought it to my heart again, and I'm going to endeavor to share this with you as the Lord has given it to me. And there came an angel of the Lord and sat under an oak, which was in Ophrah, that pertained unto Joash the Abiezrite, and his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, the Lord is with thee, the mighty man of valor. You can be seated if you would like. Today I would like to share this thought with you. If I can, I may be talking, I may be preaching, I may be screaming, I don't know, we'll see. But I want to talk about this thought. How much? How much? How much? Now, when I go to the store, if there's something that I want, I'm quick to ask somebody, if there's not a price tag on it, how much is this? Because I want to know. If I've got $30 in my wallet and what I'm looking at costs $40, I don't have enough money to buy that. So I ask, how much? What can I get? You know, you go on Amazon, or I occasionally go on Amazon. I have to stay off of there. I'm being real. I have to stay off of there. I like Amazon a little bit too much. But if I go on there, I have to consider while I'm on there. I have to count the cost and I have to consider, can I afford this or can I afford that or what can I do? So we asked the question this morning, how much? How much? And the way the Lord gave this to me is he was asking me, he said, how much is your calling worth? How much is your anointing worth? How much is the Holy Ghost that I have given you worth? And what kind of value can we put on that? And Gideon he's threshing wheat by the wine press. And he's threshing away and he's working hard. And the angel appears unto him. And we all know the story about how the Israelites had been taken over by the Midianites, and all their crops and all of their food and everything was destroyed. They had nothing to eat. They had nothing to drink. And they were in a dire strait. And that included the olive trees. That included the olive oil. And if you don't know much about olive oil, it's produced by growing olive trees, and you harvest the olives around September in that time frame. And they were crushed with what they call an oil press, and they would collect the juice in these what they call vats, basically. And this process started about 5,000 years ago, and its popularity and worth has increased ever since. Now, we use olive oil today in our cooking. Well, they used it back then, too. But it was also used back then as a lighting fuel. It's used in soap making. It was used in religious ceremonies and medicinal use. And its production was one of the major sources of income in the Holy Land over thousands of years, including modern times when the olive oil is an essential ingredient in the Middle East cuisine. Now, during the Roman and Byzantine periods, y'all bear with me, the number of oil presses was in the thousands. Many farmers had their own private installations and larger public industrial complexes generated a huge amount of olive oil. And in the area of the Golan Heights alone, 109 oil presses were found in 58 ancient sites. Most of them operated during the Roman and Byzantine period. The first step required crushing the olives using a crushing stone. Anybody ever been crushed? Anybody here ever been crushed and beat down? And collecting them into a basket. The second step was done in another installation. The basket is pressed with force, extracting the oil out of the crushed olives and collecting the juice into a storing vat. There were differences in cost between the first and the second press. The first press was the better in quality of the two presses, and it yielded the purest oil. Sometimes the press of life seems like it's too much. Sometimes the burdens of life seem like they're too much. And sometimes we feel like we are being bent to the breaking point and beyond. Have you ever taken a stick and just bent that stick? I used to do it when I was a kid. You know, I'd take a twig or a stick and I'd just bend it just to see how far I could get it before it broke. And sometimes it would spring back, and then sometimes it would just break. But sometimes we feel like we're pushed to that point to where we're almost about to break. But if we could just realize and see in the Spirit this morning that God is pressing some things out of us. That God is pressing some things out of us. And the end result of that pressing is what's important. The end result of the trial is what's important. The end result of the production process is what's important, because as I've read to you today, and I've shared this with you about all of the work that went into olive pressing and olive oil pressing, it was a laborious, long, drawn-out process. It was not something that you went out and did in just like 30 minutes. It took a long time. You had to go out. You had to cultivate that crop. Those trees had to be watered a certain way. They had to be cultivated a certain way. They had to be taken care of a certain way. It was not just something you did on the fly. It took time. It took preparation. How much time and preparation has God been putting into you? Now, I preached a while back about how God is investing in us, and I talked about that, and I want to talk about that again. How much investment has God put into our oil? How much investment has God put into our anointing? Because, see, He knew you were going to be anointed before you ever were. He knew you were going to be anointed before you ever even thought about it. You weren't even thinking about church, and God said, one day they're going to be anointed. One day they're going to be used by me. One day they're going to preach the gospel. One day they're going to be a pastor. They're going to be a teacher. They're going to be a soul winner. They're going to be an altar worker. They're going to pray people through the Holy Ghost. Because God is all about investing in our oil. That press sometimes seems like it may be too much, because we're in a long, drawn-out process. We're in a long, drawn-out process of steps, step after step after step after step. See, the woman with the issue of blood, to get to Jesus, she had to press through. She had to press through to get her healing. The Bible says she literally had to push through the press. What's it talking about? It's talking about the crowd. There were so many people around Jesus, they were on all sides pressing like this. He probably couldn't even hardly raise his arms. There were so many people around him. But she pushed through the press. She pushed through the press. She pushed through her circumstance. Her body was weak because of the blood she had lost over years and years of infection. She probably took everything she could do, probably get up that morning and get dressed. But she said, I'm going to go, and I'm going to get my healing. She said, she was looking for something. She was sick. She didn't know where Jesus was. She didn't know what street he was on. But she says, I'm going to go out, and I'm going to look, and I'm going to find something. Sometimes we don't know what we're seeking for, where it's at. But if I could just get to the house of God, I know there's going to be something there for me. If I could just get in the presence of God, I know there's going to be something there for me. I know God is going to heal me. I know God is going to touch me. I know God is going to restore me. If I could just get into His presence. And she pushed and she pressed until she got so close that she could grab a hold of the end of His garment. And because of her faith, she was healed and made whole. It was Jesus' oil that made her whole. But it was also her faith that made her whole. And we need both today. How much? How much? How much is it worth? What is the cost? The Bible tells us to count the cost. I've seen, and I'm not speaking evil of anybody, so please don't nobody get the wrong idea, but I've heard and seen ministers that jumped up and said, you know what, I'm going to go out on the road and I'm going to evangelize. And I know pastors talked about people that's done this before, and I ain't mentioned nobody in particular. I'm going to go out and I'm going to evangelize. And they get out there, and they ain't out there 2 months, and they're back home. Because it's not for everyone. Why? Because there's a cost. There's a cost. See, as other people have said, I do a fine job preaching the Word of God. But that doesn't mean I'm a pastor. That doesn't mean I'm a pastor. Because why? Because there's a cost. There's something extra sometimes that you got to give and you got to pour out of yourself to get what God has for you. People, see, we want jobs and we want, I don't know why I'm saying this, but we want jobs and we want to do things in the kingdom of God that we're not prepared for because we have not paid the price and we've not poured out and we've not pressed in. See, when you press in, then God can pour back into you. But you've got to take that first step. And there's people that's sitting on the church pew that have callings and they have gifts and they have ministries. They need to be using them. But they're not because they are not paying the price of the cost of what that oil is going to cost them. They're not paying it. Because we go to God and we say, I want to do this. God says, okay, it's going to cost you this. And we're like, whoa, how much? Whoa, how much? That's too high. I don't want to fast that much. I don't want to seek God that much. And I got this going on, God. And, you know, I got a favorite show on Netflix that I got to watch. And, you know, I just want to play my PlayStation. And, you know, I just want to go for a, you know, go out and go camping. And there's nothing wrong with those things, provided that we don't sacrifice them for the sake of our ministry and for the sake of our calling. Because, see, all these things do one thing. They consume your time. This is something God's been talking about to me about personally. They consume your time, and they take away your time, time that could be spent in seeking God, time that could be spent in studying His Word, time that could be spent in self-improvement. And I'm not just talking about a TED Talk or self-improvement in the sense of carnal self-improvement or fleshly self-improvement, but I'm talking about spiritual self-improvement because there's always room for improvement. But God is wanting to press some things out of us. You know, people don't really understand the value of what we have. Some people really don't understand the value of what we have. Because if they did, they would be banging on that door back there saying, let me in, I want what you have. They would be banging on the door saying, let me in, I want what you have. It was not until God has shut the door on the ark and the rain started to fall that those people realized that Noah had been preaching to for 120 years, realized the value of what he'd been telling them. That's when they realized it was too late. But they realized too late the value of what Noah had been preaching to them about saying, hey, get ready, there's a flood coming. Get ready. All you got to do is get in the ark. Get ready. But they realized too late the value of what he was telling him. There's value in what we have. But we cannot disesteem it today. We cannot hold it in less esteem than what it is. And there's too many people doing that today. It was Paul who wrote and said, Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world. Why? Because he didn't put any value on anything that Paul had taught him. He lost the value of what Paul had instructed him in. He lost the value of the letters that Paul had written to the churches. And I'm sure he got to read some of them. He had lost the value of saying, hey, Demas, you need to pray. Demas, you need to seek after God. Demas, you need to read the scriptures and you need to know what they mean. You need to hide it away in your heart so that you don't sin against God. He had lost the value of what Paul had taught him. Paul was his mentor. Paul was his teacher. Paul was, in essence, his pastor. And he had lost that value because he began to esteem it less and less. Can I just be real with you today? I'm just being real with you today. Not everybody's, I don't know any way to say this except to say it, but not everybody's worthy of what you have. And let me explain what I'm talking about. The Bible says not to cast your pearls before the swine. Don't cast your pearls before the swine lest they turn again and rend you. And what it's talking about is there's going to be people that you're going to talk to and you're going to want to share what God has given you. But they're not going to put the same value on it that you are. and they'll turn on you, and they'll rail on you, and they'll go behind your back, and they'll talk about you and run you down and tear you down. Why? Because they don't put the same value. Those kind of people, you don't need to waste your time. I'm not telling you not to talk to people. I'm not telling you not to go out and witness to people. I'm not telling you not to reach for people with everything you've got. But there are some people. My prayer, this is the point. My prayer today is, God, send me to somebody that's hungry for what I have. Send me to somebody that's hungry for the Word of God. Send me to somebody that's hungry for the oil that I've worked hard to get. Send me to somebody that wants a change in their life, because I'm going to tell you something right now. If they don't want to change, you ain't going to change them. And you're not going to convince them. It's going to take God doing it. It's going to take God. God's going to have to press some things out of them in order for them to see the value and realize that they need a change. Can I tell you this? That your oil is the same as anyone else's. It's the same as pastors. It's the same as mine. It's the same as Brother and Sister Phelps. It's the same as Brother Cole, Sister Kayla. This is for somebody this morning that needs to understand that the anointing and the power of God in your life is the same as what we have. We all have that same power. I didn't receive a different Holy Ghost than you. You didn't receive a different Holy Ghost than me. The Bible says it's one Spirit, multiple operations, but one Spirit that's moving through us all and working through us all. And you need to understand that your power is not diminished unless you diminish it. We're the ones that downplay the anointing of God in our lives. We're the ones that downplay the importance of what we have. We're the ones that demean ourselves and put ourselves down because we don't believe in ourselves. We're the ones that demean the power of God in us. We don't need to do that. We need to wake up and realize this morning that what we have is powerful, and that the power that the apostles had, the power that Peter had, the power that Peter and James and John and Andrew that they had, the apostles and the apostle Paul, who was the greatest apostle who ever lived, we have that power that he had. We have that same anointing that they had. You know what's holding us back? We are. A lot of times we're holding ourselves back, but we don't have to. We don't have to today. How much? How much is the oil cost today? How much is the oil worth today? Sometimes we're so focused on the cost that we miss the blessing. Sometimes we're so focused on, I got to pray every day. I got to pray every day. I got to read the Bible every day. And I got to fast because God told me I need to fast. And I just don't want to do it. And I got to talk to so-and-so down the street because God put them on my heart, and I just really don't want to do it. We're so focused on what we got to do. We're so focused on what we have to do. If we could just understand today, God's allowing me to do this. Oh, man, I get to talk to so-and-so about God. This is a privilege. I get to stand in God's presence and praise Him and worship Him. This is a privilege. I get to feel His presence. This is a privilege. We're privileged people today. We're privileged people to be in His presence today, to feel His anointing, to feel His power. Let's lift up our hands right now. Let's just magnify the name of the Lord for a moment. God, I thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity to stand behind this sacred desk. I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, Lord, to share your word, God. Lord, to be anointed, God. I thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity, God, to witness to others, God, and be used for you, by you and your kingdom. We thank you, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus. It is a privilege today. We are privileged people. We are privileged people. God's been so good to us. God's been so good to us. Stop focusing on the cost and start focusing on what we can do. Because I'm going to tell you right, a lot of those apostles and a lot of those disciples, it cost them everything. It cost them everything. But there's no way they were worried about that. Because if they had have been, they would have never went as far as they did. They would have never followed Jesus all the way to the end. They would have never went as far as they did, I'm telling you, if they were so focused on the cost. But they were focused you know what? I'm going to make heaven my home one day. And I'm going to take everybody that I can with me. They were focused on the goal. They had their minds and their eyes set on Jesus. They had their minds and their eyes set on what was going to be the end of the road, the reward that he had for them. I may be in misery right now, but I know one day I'm going to be in peace. I may be suffering right now, but one day I'm going to be comforted in the arms of Jesus. I know I'm going to make it to heaven. I know I'm going to walk the streets of gold. I know I'm going to go through those pearly gates one day. I've got a goal and I've got a mission. I'm going to see it through to the end. It was Paul that said, I fought the good fight and I've kept the faith. He wrote to Timothy when he said that. Timothy was a young pastor, but a good pastor, a powerful man of God. But he wrote that to Timothy because he wanted him to realize, Timothy, there's going to be a cost, but you can make it. Timothy, there's going to be a cost, but you can preach the word of God. You can be a mover and a shaker in the kingdom of God. You can make a difference in somebody's life. You can make a difference. Church, you can make a difference. We get so caught up in doing big things, sometimes we forget about the small things. And that's great. If you got the power and the anointing of God on you, you can walk up to somebody and pray for them and God heal them and perform a miracle in their life, that's wonderful. You need to be doing that. But sometimes a kind word goes a long way. Sometimes just sharing a scripture with somebody over a text goes a long way. Sometimes just walking up to somebody who's a little bit shy and just shaking your hand and introducing them and saying, you know, I'm glad you're here. That's a big step. That's a huge thing. God is using you. Do you know that? That is ministry. Don't underestimate the small things. How much? How much are we willing to pay today? Andrew, the brother of Peter, was crucified. He was bound, not nailed, to an X-shaped cross. He hung alive for 2 days, exhorting spectators all the while. I'm not trying to scare you, I'm just being real. Bartholomew was skinned alive and crucified. James the Greater, son of Zebedee, brother of John, was beheaded or stabbed with a sword by Herod Agrippa. His accuser was converted by James's courage, and the two were beheaded together. Whoo, man, I feel the Holy Ghost. That's powerful. That's powerful. That's not looking at the cost. That's not looking at the cost when you're sitting there and somebody's going to chop your head off. Or when you have informed on somebody else and they're about to get their head chopped off, and their attitude and their dedication and their devotion to Christ influences you so much that you kneel down and lay your head on the chopping block and say, you know what, cut my head off too. You're not worried about the consequences. You're not worried about the cost. I could go on and on. There's several different examples here of the disciples and the apostles and what they gave. How much? Our oil is priceless today. Our anointing is priceless. Our ministry is priceless. What we're doing is priceless. It's beyond cost. There was a man in the Bible that he was following the disciples around, and Peter laid his hands on some people and they received the Holy Ghost, and he was like, oh my Lord. They laid their hands on him and they received the Holy Ghost. And he asked Paul, and he wanted Peter to give Peter gold. He wanted to buy. He says, well, I want to buy this. You show me how to do this and I'm going to buy this from you. Like it could be purchased with gold. It couldn't be purchased with gold. It can't be purchased with silver. It can't be purchased with $100 bills. It can't be purchased with anything in this world. But the purchase, it's already been paid. The cost has already been paid on Calvary. It was purchased with the blood. It was purchased with the shed blood of Jesus Christ. That's why we have the anointing today. That's why we have the power today, because he paid the cost. That's why we can stand before each other. That's why we can stand before God without sin. That's why we can walk in victory today. Because somebody said, how much? I don't care. How much? It don't matter. How much? Oh, well. It doesn't matter. We need to have that attitude today of how much. Don't forget. It was Paul that said to the Orthodox Jews of his day, to the religious order of his day, he had preached to them, he had taught them, they stoned him, they ridiculed him, they beat him, and he said, you know what, from here forth I'm going to the Gentiles. He went to the people of God first, and they rejected him. He said, henceforth I'm going to the Gentiles. Why? Because they proved they were not worthy of the oil that he wanted to give them. They proved that they were not worthy of what he wanted to expound to them and what he wanted to show them, because they didn't want it. Why? Because they thought they already had it. They thought they already had what they needed. I'm good enough. I'm good enough. I'm good to go. I don't need what you got. I'm good enough. Never realizing the cost that had been paid for what Paul wanted to give them. Never realizing the value of what Paul wanted to give them. Sometimes we hold on to what we have so much, never realizing that God wants to give us something better. See, when we are saved, in salvation, there comes an exchange. There comes an exchange that's being made. Because God is like, we repent, we're baptized in Jesus' name, but there comes a point in the next step where God is like, I want to fill you with the Holy Ghost. I want to change your life. I want to completely transform you into what I want you to be. But you got to give me what you have. And little by little, through each step, we're giving up that old man. We're giving up those old habits. We're giving up those old ways that we used to go. We're not walking down the same streets that we used to walk down. We're not going to the same places that we used to go. We're not hanging out with the same friends we used to hang out with. Why? Because there's a change that started in us. There's a change that started in us. And we begin to see the value of what God has. We begin to see the value of what God wants to do in our lives. It don't matter where you come from. It don't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what sin you've committed. God can forgive. God can cleanse. God can set free. That's why he died on the cross. You've not gone too far. You've not gone too far to become unworthy of the anointing that he wants to put in your life. You've not come too far to become unworthy of the Holy Ghost that he wants to give to you. It's a gift that is freely given. You don't beg for it. You ask for it. You say, God, I don't understand what's going on. I don't understand none of what I'm feeling, but God, here I am. Here I am. Just fill me up, Lord. Use me, God. That's what he wants. He's looking for a willing vessel. He's looking for somebody that he can fill up with oil. He's looking for somebody that he can fill up with anointing. He's looking for somebody that he can use that doesn't mind getting a little uncomfortable, that doesn't mind getting a little bit out of sorts, that doesn't mind people watching and say, you know what, I don't care what they say. I don't care what they do. I don't care that they're watching me. I need something from Jesus. And then we take that next step into the Holy Ghost. I'm going to say it again. It is a gift. You know, when somebody gives me a Christmas present, they don't make me pay for it. If I give Brother Cole a gift, all right, give me $20. That ain't the way it works. A gift is freely given. You know what you do? When God offers something to you, the Holy Ghost, since we're talking about the Holy Ghost, you just say, thank you, Lord. God, I ain't worthy of it, but I thank you. I just thank you. I just thank you. I just thank you, Lord. And when you begin to thank God, believing in faith, That's what's going to move him. I ain't forgot what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the oil. I'm talking about the anointing power of the Holy Ghost. I'm talking about the oil. And we all need it today. I need it just as much as I did when I first got full of the Holy Ghost when I was 11 years old. I need it just, in fact, I need it more now. I need it more now. Because as I've gotten older, I realize how much more I need God. I realize how much I fall short as a human being. I realize my shortcomings and my mistakes and my failures, and that within myself as a human being, I'm not good enough. It doesn't matter how many New Year's resolutions I make, Brother Phelps, I ain't going to keep them. Why? Because I'm a human being. But that's why we need the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Ghost will give us power to resist sin. The Holy Ghost and the anointing power will give us power to resist Satan. It'll give us power to resist temptation. It'll give us power to overcome the enemy. And sometimes our worst enemy is ourselves. Sometimes our worst enemy is ourselves. It's our own desires, our own lust, our flesh, what we want. The anointing will help us overcome that. See, God wants you to succeed. Did you know that? Don't listen to the devil. Don't listen to the devil. He'll tell you God ain't for you. He'll tell you that, oh, he left you a long time ago, and he's not with you. He's not for you. He's not going to help you. That's a lie from the pits of hell. God wants you to succeed. He wants you to succeed on this path of life. It's his will that everyone have peace, and that everyone have joy, and that everyone have the Holy Ghost, and everyone have the goodness of God in their lives, and everything that is good and right and holy in their lives. That is his will. People think, oh, that's just for folks that's got it together. I promise you, we ain't got it together all the time. I don't. Amen. God's got it together, brother. God's got it together. Amen. Praise God. I'm so thankful the cost has been paid. You know, we may have to sacrifice sometimes in the kingdom of God. Because once after you receive the Holy Ghost, you know, that's just the beginning. There's deeper and deeper pools of anointing that you can walk into. There's deeper and deeper places that God wants to take us. Oh, that's just the beginning. I have a little teaching lesson, or I say little. It started out little, it ain't no more. But it's a teaching lesson, and I entitled it, I've Got the Holy Ghost, What Now? And it's a teaching lesson for people who have received the Holy Ghost, but don't really know what to do afterwards. See, there's so much more after that. There's so much more after that. You know, the time and energy that we spend getting the Holy Ghost and you know, you're up here and you're praying, and you got one person shaking this arm telling you to let go, and you got one person shaking this arm telling you to hold on, and you know, and everybody's praying, and everybody's gathered around, they're praying at the top of their lungs, and it's just wonderful, and it's just great, and all that effort and all that time and all that push and that press that we put into that, we have to keep doing it. What if we kept doing that? What if we kept pushing and we kept pressing? Because, you know, when you were seeking for the Holy Ghost, I don't know about you, but I was in the altar every service. I was in the altar every service. It took me over a year to get the Holy Ghost just because I didn't understand how to let go. I didn't understand how to let go and let God be. I didn't understand. But if we could just keep pushing the way we did when we first got the Holy Ghost, there's nothing wrong with coming down to the altar. There's nothing wrong with coming down to the altar. And growing up in the church, you know, you get this stigmatism of the altar's just for the unsaved, or the altar's just for the unforgiven, or the altar's just for those that need, you know, need saving and need salvation. No. The altar is for everybody. The altar is for every man, woman, and child on this earth. That's what the altar is for. That's where the oil is pressed out. Uda Maria Andrea Kanadaboho Shika Yandra is upon that altar. That's where the oil is pressed out. That's where the anointing comes from. It's from that altar. I've heard old timers tell me my whole life, if you want to be anything in the kingdom of God, you need to pray. If you want to be a powerful minister, get on your knees and find a prayer life. Get a relationship with God. If you're going to be something in the kingdom of God. Like I said, going back to the beginning of the lesson, it's going to take work. I wish I could tell you that we just get on a sliding board, slide right into heaven. It don't work like that, unfortunately. But we have this promise. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. We may be on an uphill climb, but guess who's there climbing with you? Jesus. Every step you're taking, he's right there. He's pushing you up that hill. Pushing you up that hill, encouraging you, saying, it's all right, you got just a few more steps. Just keep going. It's all right. You ain't got much further to go. Come on, keep pushing. You're almost there. Keep pushing. Don't give up now. Don't turn around now. Oh, just keep going. You're almost there. You're almost to the horizon. You're almost to the top of the mountain. If you'll just keep going, you have no idea what's in store for you at the top of that mountain. Just keep pressing. Keep pressing. Keep pressing. Keep moving. Amen. Praise God. I just want to thank God. I just want to thank God for his mercy. I just want to thank God for his grace. I've been in, like I said earlier, I've been in church my whole life. But I need his grace just as much as anybody else. Why? Because I was born into sin. I was born into sin. I was born with a sin nature. And I needed Jesus just as much as anybody else. Never underestimate how bad you need Jesus. Never downplay how much you need Jesus. There's nothing wrong with admitting you need him. We want to be macho men sometimes. I don't need nobody. We get in a fight with our wife and we don't. Whatever. It didn't bother me. On the inside, we're just all to pieces. But on the outside, we're just, I don't care. I don't care. I'm good. No. We're not good. There's something awesome and something great about surrendering to Jesus. There is such a blessing in surrendering to him. There's such a blessing in submission to him, in submission to his will, in submission to his spirit. There is such a blessing in surrendering to the anointing and to the Holy Ghost. There's a great blessing in that. And I'm so thankful that he saw something that was worth something in me. I'm so thankful that he saw something that was worth something in me, brother. Because sometimes I didn't see anything in myself. But God sees us not as we are, but as what we can be. He doesn't see the drug addict. He sees the Sunday school teacher. He doesn't see the prostitute. He sees the soul winner. He doesn't see the murderer. He sees the preacher. He sees the apostle. He sees the prophet. He sees us as we will be. And I'm so thankful that he does. I'm so thankful. In Jesus' name, praise God. I guess that's all I got this morning. I hope this has blessed your heart. And Pastor, do you want to come up and say anything? All right. So we'll go ahead and dismiss until the 11 o'clock service and come ready to worship. Amen. Amen.